This presentation is about utilizing a C-arm for 3D fluoroscopy and more.
Welcome, and I hope you enjoy the presentation. This animation shows a cone beam flat panel CT acquisition of data for a 3D fluoroscopic exam. As you can see on the display, the system actually performs not only 3D examinations, but vascular examinations and regular fluoro. In combination with digital flat panel detectors, cone beam CT has high spatial resolution with isotropic voxel size. This allows for high resolution image reconstruction in any plane, including 3D rotational reconstruction. Cone beam CT is known by many names and therefore can be somewhat confusing as the names are being interchanged, because cone beam CT is also referred to as C-arm CT, cone beam volume CT, or flat panel CT. The term cone comes from the divergent cone-shaped source of radiation, which is directed through the patient. A digital flat panel detector, which is comprised of an active matrix array of detector electronics, receives the beam or absorbs the beam after it goes through the patient. The flat panel CT used with cone beam fluoroscopy describes a CT system that uses a flat panel detector. CBCT or FBCT, they are not the same. C stands for computed tomography. We begin by seeing a two-dimensional planar X-ray, and next we take a look at linear tomography. After that, we have tomosynthesis, and then CT scanners, and finally cone beam CT. On the bottom of the image, we see tomosynthesis and a computed axial tomography system, or CT. Tomosynthesis is used in conjunction with a computer, but the acquisition rotation is less than 360 degrees. For computed axial tomography, we have a 360 degree acquisition. As we discussed earlier, the cone beam CT refers to any modality that uses a wide angle field of view. The fluoroscopic cone beam CT scanner uses a flat panel image receptor and digital pulsed fluoroscopy to create images. The flat panel enables the fluoroscopy unit to get high resolution images, while the use of pulse digital fluoroscopy reduces the patient exposure. Three-dimensional fluoroscopic units with cone beam CT acquire images at an angle of less than 360 degrees in one rotation. Let's take a look at the C-arm clearance and how we utilize the C-arm to get the acquisition of images. This is tomosynthesis. It allows us to do simultaneously a view of the three-dimensional object while performing surgery. These C-arm systems allow the operator to do all the functions of a traditional system, but also do fluoroscopy, vascular, and 3D imaging. The advantages of digital fluoroscopy over conventional fluoroscopy are the speed of image acquisition and post-processing capability to enhance image contrast. The production of the ionizing radiation beam also differs in the fact that in a traditional system, we use a beam where we're using continuous fluoroscopy that is less than 5 mA. These systems operate in pulse progressive fluoro. It essentially pulses the X-ray production from the fluoroscopic X-ray tube in synchronization with detector signal. Images are acquired in short pulses that are so fast that they cannot be visualized with the naked eye and therefore seem like continuous motion. Using digital fluoroscopy that operates in a pulse progressive mode, we receive less radiation to the patient and better quality images. This image shows grilled pulsed fluoroscopy and how we are able to reduce the dosage using grid pulse fluoroscopy when compared to continuous fluoroscopy. In our comparison here, we can see that we can get reductions between 30 and 82.5% in a direct correlation between using continuous fluoroscopy and pulsed fluoroscopy. Using cone beam CT in fluoroscopy, the C-arm performs a sweep around the patient, acquiring up to several hundred two-dimensional views. They serve as input for the 3D cone beam reconstructions. This results in a voxel data set that can be visualized as either cross-sectional images or as a 3D set of data through volume rendering. Such a rotation takes between 5 and 20 seconds, during which the few hundred 2D images are acquired. Among the current CDCR models on the market, the Siemens Arcadis Orbic is the only system that is truly isocentric. Its 190-degree rotation makes it the only model that offers exact anatomy imaging. Other manufacturers at this time do not have the isocentric capability, but utilize a software adjustment for modeling the 3D images to look like actual anatomical images. The tomosynthesis is acquired at 190 degrees on the Siemens, while the other units acquire the images at between 115 and 145 degrees. The operator selects the technical factors, but collimation to the receptor, the object scanned, and the time of rotation are all factors in patient dose, and we try to reduce patient dose. Cone beam CT uses filtered back projection in creating the images. For imaging processing and analysis, what we find is that the computer receives the pre-processed acquisition data or projections. The computer then filters these projections, tweaking the data to enhance images and provide the type of constructions requested. After the images are tweaked, use back projection to project the images back. An algorithm is a computer instruction. Let's look at this reconstruction process graphically. Notice that in our reconstruction, we call it an approximation because only one manufacturer uses true isocentric voxel reconstructions. Another configuration that uses 3D CT cone beam and fluoroscopy is the Medtronic O-arm system. The Medtronic O-arm has limited functionality and is used only in surgery, whereas the fluoroscopic C-arm can be used anywhere. This system creates 3D images. The 3D images are then stored in the computer's navigation system. These 3D images serve as templates for real-time fluoroscopy during surgery. The O-arm is mobile and it can be moved out of position after the images are acquired in surgery. Let's see how the O-arm impacts on the surgical workflow. The patient is scanned in radiology and then transported to the surgical suite, and then the surgical suite actually performs the procedure utilizing the images collected in radiology. The O-arm allows you to create the images in surgery itself.
This is what's called the Medtronic O-arm. It's a combination of traditional fluoroscopy with also a three-dimensional imaging component. Within 26 seconds, it will take 755 high-definition images. With the O-arm, we can actually take shots of the spine in a three-dimensional nature because the spine is a three-dimensional structure. And the value of that to a surgeon is that they can now see the spine in three dimensions and truly be able to determine with precise accuracy their placement of the hardware. The device also enables minimally invasive surgery. By more precisely placing the screws, he's going to be able to allow the patient to have a quicker recovery time and hopefully have a better quality of life post-surgery due to the more accurate placement of the hardware which the O-arm enables. We have the O-arm itself, which collects the images. We have the viewing cart, which the images are reconstructed on. And then we also have the stealth navigation image-guided surgery unit. After the images are recreated on the spinal navigation unit, the surgeon is able to bring different surgical instruments into the field that will help him more effectively place the instrumentation into the patient's back in a three-dimensional nature. Because this device is used interoperatively, the surgeon can use the image-guided surgery unit to do the remainder of the case without additional radiation being delivered to the patient. The benefit of that is to the patient that they will potentially not need to be sent for a post-operative CT to check the final placement of their hardware, since they're able to do that real time in the operating room.
Here we see a simulation of the O-arm coming into the surgical suite and doing a preliminary scan. Then the surgeon actually places the screws using the stealth monitor over the co-registered 3D images, and when the surgeon finishes, the O-arm comes back in, takes a final image, and the exam is done. O-arm goes back out of the room. Images can be acquired as standard protocols or using a low-dose protocol. When the images are acquired, the staff can leave the room, reducing their amount of radiation exposure. Let's watch a video of this process so you can get a better idea of how the system is utilized.
You rely on instinct and expertise to execute spinal procedures every day. You are stealth. What more could enable you? With critical images in real time to help you navigate more procedures, from the single-level fusion to the most complex. With increased visualization, instrument choices shown the way you need. With your input, we've developed a system that's designed to let you do more. Introducing Stealth Station S8. This powerful system gives you automatic registration to intraoperative O-arm images. Seamlessly utilize your wide range of navigated spine instruments. With the Stealth Station S8, actively navigate an instrument while configurations of another are changed, delivering what you need when you need it. A system designed for the procedures you perform. A system of software, imaging, and instruments that give you the flexibility to do what you need. Every detail is engineered to exceed your expectations. The technology you choose is a reflection of your work, Only the best tools for the best care. You are Stealth.
To begin with, to properly utilize 3D fluoroscopy, operators should have certified radiation safety training, comprehensive knowledge of the equipment they are using, and be skilled at the procedure being performed. Using cone beam CT for 3D fluoroscopy, we create image slices. These slices are stacked to create a voxel or a solid block of data or image. This is what we utilize for our 3D fluoroscopy. The operator selects the time of exposure. The operator selects the amount of ionizing radiation used for the exposure, which we call milliamperage or MA, and the operator selects the kVp or kilovolts peak that is used to penetrate the tissue. These factors are called exposure technique, and MA or milliamperage is the ionizing radiation, which is the only portion of this that can hurt you. We use low-dose ionizing radiation in the production of medical images. If routine low-dose medical imaging exams are done appropriately, there's only a theoretical risk of harm to patients. There is considerable uncertainty regarding the risk estimates for low levels of radiation exposure as commonly experienced in diagnostic radiology procedures to do harm. This is because the risk is quite low compared to the natural risk of cancer. If a patient showed some sort of deterministic ionizing radiation exposure, we are not using low dose, we are using high doses. Let's view this video on ionizing radiation to get a little bit better understanding of ionizing radiation and how it impacts our body.
The picture. X-rays were discovered in 1895 by Willem Röntgen. But how do we measure radiation entering our bodies? This is important to discuss as biologic effects are related to absorbed doses of radiation. Radiation absorbed dose, RAD, measures the deposition of radiation in any type of tissue, while radiation equivalent man measures human exposure.
To date, there is no evidence of genetically heritable risk in humans from exposure to X-rays. Under some rare circumstances of prolonged high-dose exposures, X-rays can cause adverse health effects, such as skin reddening or erythema, skin injury, and birth defects in utero. At exposure levels associated with medical imaging procedures, these effects do not occur, even with CT procedures. Know your imaging system. Most of the imaging procedures in the operating theater utilize an image intensifier or fluoroscopy with a flat panel detector. Modern digital imaging intensifiers have several pre- and post-processing features. This is especially true if your system includes 3D fluoroscopy and CBCT. It's very embarrassing if you don't know how to perform a task on your system. This is particularly so when the surgeon knows that the other radiographers have performed this task. A surgeon will probably forgive you for not being familiar with a special surgical procedure, but will be less forgiving if you are struggling to use your equipment. The surgeon will look to you for signs of confident and competent operation of the equipment. This will be very difficult if you are unfamiliar with a procedure. There will be a variety of procedures that you will be expected to assist with. Let's take a look at basic safety in fluoroscopy. As we discussed earlier, you need to be familiar with your imaging equipment. And also, when you're doing a procedure, what are the typical doses that the patient receives during the procedure? Factors that influence dose are patient size, kVp, MA, and time, the SSD or tube to patient distance, the image intensifier to patient distance, the use of non-grid and grids, image magnification, X-ray field size, and the angle of the view. You should be familiar with the state regulations on the practice of fluoroscopy. You should be familiar with your patient's history. You need to record the fluoro times on the patient's files. You also need to identify skin areas that have been irradiated and monitor patient doses. At times, you might need to use patient counseling and consent forms. Now we'll talk about the last two areas of safety with your fluoroscopic equipment. Equipment quality control is essential, and you need to have periodic PMs or preventive maintenance done on the equipment. You need to have your calibrations done promptly. You need to be able to post radiation output values, and you need to check your aprons, shields, and gloves annually. Finally, your facility needs to have standard operating procedures. Current radiation safety and fluoroscopy training programs are based mainly on theoretical knowledge and are lacking in practical application. During the procedure, operators should never be exposed to the primary radiation. Operators should only be subject to stray or scatter radiation, which is emitted from the patient and some from the equipment. The stray or scatter radiation is very small because the primary radiation has mainly been absorbed by the patient. There is also less scatter radiation the further you are from the patient. The patient dose varies with the length of the exposure to ionizing radiation and other factors such as the equipment placement. The operator's primary source of radiation exposure is Compton interactions that occur in the patient, or scatter radiation. Understanding the physics of radiation exposure, and especially the inverse square law, is helpful not only for the operators, but for the staff that is in the room while the surgical procedure is being accomplished. The inverse square law tells us that the dose of radiation is inversely proportioned to the square of the distance from the source. In other words, the farther you are away, the less dose you'll receive. If you're out of the primary beam, the source for radiation exposure in the room is the patient, and the patient is emitting scatter radiation. Let's use the inverse square to take a look at the exposure to staff from scatter radiation. This exposure is reduced to 1/1000th the exposure the patient is receiving from the primary beam if you are standing 3 feet away. The staff is protected furthermore by the lead vests and thyroid collars and leaded glasses that they are wearing. So what we're looking at is the fact that the scatter radiation, which has been reduced to 1/1000th the exposure the patient receives, is then blocked by the radiation protection gear the staff wears. The radiation protection gear absorbs about 98% plus of this scatter radiation that the staff receives. So as you can see, the staff is receiving minimal amounts of radiation. Since the physician and staff are pretty well protected, physicians should be aware of the radiation exposure that they are actually giving the patient. Physicians performing these procedures should be aware of the potential for serious radiation-induced injury caused by long periods of fluoroscopy during these procedures. It is important to note that the onset of these injuries is usually delayed so that the physician cannot discern or see the damage immediately. There are large numbers of reports have extremely long procedures based upon the fact that the surgery was complicated and the physician did not know how to optimize the utilization of fluoro, therefore having long extended fluoro times. Proper training of fluoroscopic operators, understanding the factors that influence radiation dose, and the use of various dose reduction techniques may allow effective management of patient dose. To date, there are no uniform national standards regarding who may operate fluoroscopy systems or what minimum training they should have. None of the credentialing processes mandate that resident physicians, especially those who work with radiation, learn about radiation management in fluoroscopic procedures. I was last in my class, barely passed at the In interventional fluoroscopy and in fluoroscopic surgery procedures, physicians performing these procedures should be aware of the potential for serious radiation-induced skin injury caused by long periods of fluoroscopy during the procedure. Here we see the erythema, or the burn, caused by the ionizing radiation. This only happens when we have an extremely long, protracted procedure. Long and protracted procedures usually happen when we have either a training situation or a physician that is not as knowledgeable and skilled in the procedure that they are performing as they should be, and therefore it requires a longer amount of time. We have recorded several of these incidents, with fluoroscopic time being in excess of 2 and 3 hours. But again, this is beyond the norm. Patients should never be subjected to enough ionizing radiation to cause erythema. Early transient erythema occurs after exposures as little as 200 rads of radiation. It will appear in several hours, it peaks at about 24 hours, and it fades in several days. For doses exceeding 600 rads, this will be followed by the main erythema effect, which usually appears at 10 days, peaks at 2 weeks, and fades around 4 weeks after irradiation. There are a number of factors that actually do contribute to overexposures, such as the closeness of the imaging source, or ionizing radiation source, to the patient themselves. Minimizing beam on time is probably one of the best controls that we have. Medical imaging is evolving at a rapid pace due to computerization and new modality design. At the same time, the quantity of ionizing radiation used to create diagnostic information is being reduced. Many exams that used ionizing radiation have been replaced by newer imaging modalities that do not use ionizing radiation, such as MRI and ultrasound. Radiation safety is a matter of risk versus benefits to the patient, as the patient absorbs the direct beam and operators are only exposed to scatter radiation, which is minimal exposure.